Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Andrew Levander, the chairman of Dechert, and I thank you for being here for a special conversation with Mary Ann Sieghart in celebration of International Women's Day. Before we get started, I'd like to express my thanks to the Dechert's Global Women's Initiative for planning this event. The initiative is led now by partners Christina Sarchio and Carol Widger, and I would be remiss if I didn't have a shout out for Abby Cohn, who toiled in doing great things for the Women's Initiative for so many years. And I'd also like to thank all of you who are here, and particularly clients and guests who joined us today. Now, International Women's Day has received a lot more attention in recent years, but it's actually over a century old. And International Women's Day is a global day celebrating the social, economic, cultural, and political achievements of women throughout the world. The day is equally important because it represents a critical call to action for gender parity in every community across the globe. International Women's Day is a global day celebrating, as I said, the achievements of women around the world in every respect, social, economic, business, and political. But this year, our particular thoughts go out to the families, women, and children displaced by the unfolding violence in the Ukraine. On a personal level, the in-laws of friends, very good friends of mine, were trapped in Ukraine. They're Ukrainians. And as a testament to the day, the mother refused to leave her son and husband, even though she could have gotten out. And today I learned that they've all made it to Romania. So at least one case, thank goodness. But a mother's courage at its best. The 2022 theme for International Women's Day is Break the Bias. This year's theme reinforces the idea that each of us have a role and responsibility in forging gender equality, and a true gender equality. And one way we can do this is by making a commitment to recognize and call out significant impact that bias has on women's equality, both conscious and unconscious. As we know, these biases can translate into systemic inequities, resulting in pay gaps, gender health gaps, and gender leadership gaps. In line with this theme, we've invited Mary Ann as our guest speaker today. She's a highly regarded current affairs commentator and presenter whose best-selling book, The Authority Gap, looks at how and we still don't take women seriously as we should and what we can do about that. I promise you that her remarks are going to challenge each of us to do better. Today's conversation will be moderated by Melanie McKay, a litigation partner in our Chicago office. And given that it's the day that it is, I'm proud to say that Melanie is one of our newest partners. And in that group of 30 partners, 16 were women. So some progress somewhere. And I see Mary Ann smiled. And with that, I'll turn it over to Melanie and to Mary Ann.
Thank you, Andy. So we are so honored to have Mary Ann Sieghart with us. Just a brief background, if you'll indulge me. Mary Ann is an impressive journalist and author. She has extensive TV and radio experience as a current affairs and political correspondent. Mary Ann spent 20 years as assistant editor and columnist at The Times, and she won a large following for her columns on politics, economics, feminism, parenthood, and really just life in general. She has presented many programs on BBC Radio 4, including Start of the Week, Profile, Analysis, Fallout, and One-to-One. She chaired the revival of the Brains Trust on BBC Two, and recently spent a year as a visiting fellow of All Souls College, Oxford. She's chaired the Social Market Foundation Think Tank, is a visiting professor at King's College London, and sits on numerous boards. She's also chair of the judges for the Women's Prize for Fiction 2022. As Andy mentioned, Mary Ann is well known for her book, The Authority Gap, which is right here. If you don't have it, you should go get it. It's a fantastic and very compelling read. It's a finalist in the Business Book Awards this year in the diversity, inclusion, and equality category. This book provides a truly startling perspective on the unseen bias at work and in our everyday lives. And it explores and reveals the scale of the gap that still persists, that still persists today between men and women. So Marianne, welcome. It's so great to have you.
Thank you. Very kind of you to have me on International Women's Day.
Right, exactly. So before we begin, I just want to remind everyone that if you have questions, please just drop them in the Q&A box. You should see like a little Q&A icon, and then I will be thrilled to relay them to Marianne. So I think the first question is obvious, right? It's what is the authority gap?
Yes, the authority gap is the extent to which we're still more reluctant to accord authority to women than to men. We still take men more seriously than women. And when I say authority, I mean both in terms of expertise and also in terms of leadership and power. And in fact, when I was giving a lecture in Oxford on this subject, I thought, well, I better define my terms. So I literally just Googled authority and definition. Very first result that came up was from the Oxford Online Dictionary. And guess what? Every single example of the use of the word authority began with the same pronoun. And I think you can guess which it was. So there was, he had the natural authority of one who was used to being obeyed. He hit the ball with authority. He was an authority on the stock market. And I was thinking, hang on a minute, didn't Margaret Thatcher have the natural authority of one who was used to being obeyed? Doesn't Serena Williams hit the ball with authority? You're just still much more reluctant to associate female or women with authority than we are men. And the result of that is that we tend to underestimate women. We often patronize them. I'm sure you've been in a position where you've gone into a meeting and everyone's assumed that you were the secretary rather than the partner, that sort of thing. We're much more likely to interrupt women or to talk over them in meetings. We're much more reluctant to let them influence our decisions. So when a woman makes a point in a meeting, it's much harder for her to influence the meeting than it is for a man. And we're much more likely to challenge her expertise. And if she is in a position of power or leadership, we quite often feel uncomfortable and we're often, we're reluctant to accept her authority over us.
Mm-hmm. I love this term. I had never heard it before. Did you coin it or?
I coined it.
You did.
Okay. No, I coined it.
Okay. It really just, I feel like precisely pinpoints the issue in a way that hasn't been articulated before. So I love it. Can you talk about the evidence that you found that proves the authority gap still exists?
Okay, so I'm going to give you two types of evidence. The first sounds anecdotal, but is actually very scientific. And this is the experience of trans people. And why this is interesting is that generally, if you're a woman, say you are up for a promotion alongside a male colleague and he gets it and you don't, and you may suspect that bias was at play, but it's terribly hard to prove. He may just be better than you. But if you look at the experience of trans people who are exactly the same person with the same ability and intelligence and personality and experience and body of work, and if they're treated completely differently once they start living in a different gender, then what you've done is you've corrected for all the other variables and isolated the one that matters, which is gender. So I tell the story in my book of two Stanford science professors who each transition in opposite directions by chance at the same time. Ben Barres, who was a neuroscientist, once he started living as a man, he said, I've had the thought a million times, I'm just taken more seriously now. My work is taken more seriously, the same damned work, as he put it, is taken more seriously now that people see me as a man. And someone who didn't know his history was overheard in the back of one of his seminars saying, oh, Ben Barres gave a great seminar today, but then his work's so much better than his sister's, i.e. his own work. And meanwhile, Joan Roughgarden, an evolutionary biologist, transitioned in the opposite direction. And she said when she was living as a man, she just felt like she was on a conveyor belt to success. Life was just incredibly easy. She spoke, people listened, she applied for grants and got them. People might sometimes disagree with what her thesis was in her work, but they did so in a very polite way. Once she started living as a woman, she said all that changed. So she came up against all the sort of behavior that I'm talking about, being patronized, corrected, interrupted, talked over, personally attacked. This annoyed her more than anything else. She said people would say to her things like, you haven't read the literature. And she said, that never happened to me when they saw me as a man. And she said, to start with, I thought, well, if I'm going to live as a woman, I'm darn well going to be discriminated against like a woman. And she said, well, the thrill of that's worn off, I can tell you. And her conclusion was, men are assumed to be competent until proven otherwise. Women are assumed to be incompetent until proven otherwise. Now, this may sound anecdotal, but actually sociologists have done much bigger surveys of trans men and women and have found exactly the same phenomenon. And then there are also scientific academic research studies of all the manifestations of the authority gap. So there's one, for instance, interruptions. You might think that once you become a very authoritative woman, you would be insulated from this sort of behavior, but no. So a study was done quite recently of US Supreme Court proceedings. And you don't get much more authoritative than being a US Supreme Court justice. But although women make up only a third of the justices, they suffer two thirds of all interruptions. So they're four times more likely to be interrupted than their male counterparts, 96% of the time by men. And another study, which I found fascinating, was, you know, this phenomenon that women quite often encounter of making a point at a meeting and no one takes a blind bit of notice. 10 minutes later, a man makes the same point and is widely applauded for his brilliance. This is very common. And we tend to beat ourselves up and think, oh, maybe I wasn't confident enough, or maybe I wasn't articulate enough, I wasn't eloquent enough. No, you were probably just too female. Because another study put together a mixed gender group of people to discuss a child custody case. And they deliberately chose this topic because it's actually quite female stereotyped. You'd expect women to be good at it. And they gave the group all sorts of information about the family concerned and the parents and the children. But they gave a few individuals a piece of information that none of the others had. And when that piece of information was introduced by a man, it was six times more likely to be used by the group in its deliberations than when it was introduced by a woman. Six times more likely. That's how much harder we have to fight to influence a room.
So when I read your book, I'm really excited to ask you this question. I felt so seen, right? Like I was like, these are my stories. The first couple chapters are all these stories that are so difficult to articulate, right? When you're talking about unconscious bias, it's really hard to put words around it that make it seem like a real thing. So I felt like I was a part of something. And then I felt a little depressed, right? Because you have this idea that as you progress in your career, you're going to see less or fewer instances of the authority gap arise. But then you really march through all these examples of that not being the case, right? You talk to the Prime Minister of Australia, the two-time President of Chile, the CEO of Xerox and other companies, and the highest ranking female in the military. And they're all saying the same thing. And so you start to feel a little bit depressed, right? Melanie McCain, Chicago, like, well, they're experiencing it, right? When will the end ever approach, right? But then at the end, I have to say, I really did feel grateful because you conclude your book with a lot of sort of, work that we can do to try to improve this. And I think it's just really nice to have information an awareness around this. And so my question to you really is, how many women get stuck on that middle feeling, right? The despair and depression. And in writing your book, did you sort of experience these ranges of emotions as well?
Yes. I mean, I think almost all the very senior women I spoke to said it gets easier as you get more senior. It doesn't completely disappear, like I was saying with the US Supreme Court justices. But I think it gets easier once you have been accorded public authority. And so, for instance, I spoke to several former prime ministers, and they generally said, actually, once I became prime minister, it was easier because I was actually at the top. Though even then, they could still think of instances. So Michelle Bachelet, for instance, as you say, twice president of Chile, she said that she would have these political meetings, and at the end of the meeting, she would sum up what was going to be done, and she'd say, right, so we've decided we're going to do A, B, and C. And there was a male colleague of hers who could never resist having the last word, as if it was he who was summing up the meeting, even though she was president. So it does carry on. But I do think, nonetheless, I think it does get easier. Did it make me feel depressed? In a way, but in a way not, because what I really liked was that I managed to find so much objective evidence proving this. And I think part of the depression comes from a feeling of being almost gaslit. Do you use the expression gaslighting in the US?
Yeah.
When you're always made to feel a bit crazy for feeling something. And I think until I amassed all this evidence, a lot of women would have thought, well, I felt like I was being undermined, but was I really? And if you call a man out for it, he says, no, I never said that, or I never meant that. And then you start feeling a bit crazy. And actually, I think seeing all this evidence is going to make women feel more confident that it's nothing personal. It's not about them. It's a systemic problem that we all suffer from. And I think that actually ought to cheer women up. And I hope it will make men think as well.
Right. I agree. Yes. That was absolutely my end reaction. But as I was reading it, it was just so daunting, honestly. It was amazing that you found so much objective evidence, honestly, because you really thought about it almost like a scientist would, right? Like you went out and you proved this.
Well, I really wanted it to be watertight because I knew that otherwise there would be a lot of backlash from skeptical men. I mean, lots of men are brilliant. And I've worked with some fantastic ones and I have no complaint at all. I love them. I really appreciate them. But there are some men I knew who would be skeptical and who would take issue with it and tell me I'd got it all wrong and dispute the thesis, thereby actually proving the very point of my book, that women's authority gets disproportionately challenged, even if they know more about the subject than the person who's challenging them. But nonetheless, I really didn't want that to happen. And so I absolutely packed it with evidence. I think there's a 30-page bibliography because I wanted this to be indisputable.
Right. Can you talk a little bit about sort of the pervasiveness of the issue? Because I think a lot of people sort of write it off as like, oh, that's just an old guy problem, right? You really show that it's not. And so I'd love for you to talk about that.
Yes. I mean, actually, this was something that both surprised and depressed me. I was surprised. I thought that young men would be much less biased than older men. Because after all, these, you know, millennials and Gen Zs, they're antennae are so acutely attuned to racism, homophobia, transphobia. So I would have thought that, you know, sexism would be just a horrifying thought for them. But no, there were lots of studies showing, for instance, there was one done of biology students at college, and they were asked to nominate who were the smartest and best informed members of their class. And they were asked to do this all the way through the year. The young women, on the whole, were very accurate at identifying who were the smartest and best informed. The young men almost uniformly chose other men, even if the women were better. And that's age 20, 21. And there were some, I mean, I spoke to some students at Oxford about their experiences, and they were telling me things like, oh, the boys, they just don't think we're their intellectual equals. I thought, not their intellectual equals. You know, when actually girls outperform boys all the way through school, all the way through college, right up to PhD level. But there's still this sense of male superiority, even among young men. And actually on the implicit association test, which at least tries to measure unconscious bias, it has its critics, but nonetheless, it measures how quickly and accurately you can associate male and female words with, say, office and home words. Young people are actually slightly more biased than older people.
Yeah, it's shocking, right? Because
and
I've absolutely run into this as well. You know, you meet young men, right? They're millennials. You think you're a part of a more woke generation, right? They might even call themselves feminists. I'm wondering to what extent, you know, young people tend to think, well, I believe in gender equality. I believe in racial equality. So I couldn't possibly be exhibiting you know, unconscious bias, and sort of kind of give themselves a pass and don't think critically about their own, you know, actions.
I think that's right. And one of the most important points I make in the book is that however intelligent or liberal or woke or even female we are, we probably do harbor unconscious bias against women, even women do, because we've all been brought up in the same world in which men have basically been in charge. And we, most of us have grown up in families in which our father probably earned more than our mother, possibly worked more than our mother, maybe had more authority at home than our mother. And so that infects, it sort of ingrains us with the stereotypes of associating male with authority. So women do it too. And there's nothing we can do about unconscious bias. It's called unconscious for a reason. We can't put a lid on it. And actually, we shouldn't even be ashamed of it, because there's not a lot we can do about it. But what we can do is notice when it manifests itself and then correct for it. And that's what I'd like these young men, indeed all men and women, to do.
Yeah, that actually leads me, we got a question in the Q&A. You mentioned gaslighting, and someone's hoping you can say more about gaslighting, specifically when it comes from women, right, and not men.
I think it comes much more often from men than from women in my experience. I haven't seen any academic research to back this up. I think there are some women who are often known as queen bees, who have managed to be successful, who've managed to navigate their way through all this, and then sort of want to deny that sexism exists for the next generation. So I think because they've sort of had to join the male gang in order to succeed, they then feel that they're not allowed to be feminists once they get there. Or even just to, feminism only means believing in equality. But, you know, they don't want to speak out for equality once they get there, because otherwise they feel they'll be rejected by their male colleagues, perhaps.
Yeah. Can you speak a little bit about the challenges a woman faces who's trying to display competence and confidence and authority?
Yeah. So this is really difficult for women. And I did explore in the book the question of confidence a lot, because I think it's very important. I think one of the reasons why we take men more seriously than women is because they present their views with more confidence on the whole than women do. Why is that? Well, it starts from very early on in life. One of the saddest pieces of research I came across was that parents, when asked to estimate their children's IQ, will estimate their sons at 115 and their daughters at only 107. Which is the most enormous statistical difference, despite the fact that girls actually develop faster than boys, they have a bigger vocabulary at an earlier age than boys, and they do much better, as I said, at school and at college than boys do. And we all know that the distribution of IQs between the genders is absolutely identical, except at the very far ends of the bell curve. So boys are growing up subliminally absorbing this notion that they're cleverer than girls, and girls are growing up subliminally absorbing the notion that they are less clever than boys, even though that isn't the case. And this then, I think, continues into adulthood. So if you ask adult males to estimate their own IQ, they put it at 110 on average, women 105 on average. So that means that men will feel more intellectually confident than men, than women, based on entirely inaccurate information. And lots of evidence shows that men actually overestimate their ability, whereas women tend to be much more accurate or to underestimate their ability. Then when you layer on top of that, all these instances of authority gap behavior that women come across and men on the whole don't. You know, if every time you put an idea up, people either ignore it or shoot it down, if you get interrupted, if you get talked over, of course that's going to dent your confidence in a way that men don't have their confidence dented. Nonetheless, the answer is not simply to say, send women on assertiveness training courses, teach them to be more confident, ask them to lean in, and the problem will be solved. Because even if we do behave as confidently and as assertively as men, we still get punished, because people don't like it when women do that. They start recoiling and saying, oh, she's quite abrasive, isn't she? Or she's quite strident, or she's aggressive or bossy or overbearing, even the B word. You know, if a woman is tough, we dislike her. If a man is tough, we admire him. There are so many double standards. These are all words that aren't used of men, things like abrasive and strident and bossy and overbearing. Why do we do this? It's because we still have these sneaky little ridiculously out of date stereotypes that tell us that women ought to be gentle and warm and caring and nurturing and unassertive and unthreatening and uncompetitive and unself-promoting and cooperative and emollient, whereas men ought to be confident and assertive and be in charge and show leadership. Now, if women behave according to the female stereotype, they're not going to be taken seriously at all. So if they're not confident enough, they will be disrespected. But if they are confident enough and behave like the men, they will quite often be disliked. And you might say, oh, well, women just need to grow thicker skin. Who cares if people like you? Actually, in career terms, it's terribly important because likability is a much more important factor for women when it comes to hiring and promotion than it is for men, particularly if it's men doing the hiring. So how do we get over this? You may ask. It does sound ridiculously depressing, and it is, but it can be done. And all the women I interviewed, in fact, the very successful women I interviewed for the book, said that what they try to achieve is what's known as warm authority. And the academic research backs this up, that if you overlay oodles of warmth onto your personality, you can somehow mitigate the dislike that you will otherwise attract for being confident and competent and assertive. So we have to smile more, we have to leaven everything with humor, we have to be very emotionally intelligent, read the room, make sure we're not treading on any male egos, and then we'll probably find our way through. But it is exhausting. And it's a burden that men don't have to bear. And the other thing that we do, I'm afraid, is that we tend to mistake confidence for competence. And men, if men are always going to be more confident than women, and we take them at their word, then we're more likely to hire them and promote them, even if they have an inaccurate estimation of their ability. So we're more likely to hire and promote the overconfident, but not particularly competent man than the underconfident, but probably super competent women.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there's a risk? I had never put a name to it. When you said warm authority, I knew exactly what you meant when you were describing it. I feel like it's the balance I'm always trying to achieve. So perfectly described. And my question is there... You know, men don't have to do that, right? They can just be authoritative. They don't have to also be warm and put smiles on their face and exclamation points in their emails all the time just to make sure that it's well received. But women, I find, do. And I just wonder if it can backfire as well for women, right? Because if you're too warm, right, then now you're too smiley, you're ditzy. So you're trying, you need to do it, but you can't do too much of it. And at a certain point, does it start to backfire?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. So, you know, two exclamation marks, complete no-no, but you might want to put one in just to show warmth. I mean, basically, we need the agility of Simone Biles on the balance beam to get all this right, whereas men can just saunter along the floor.
Right.
But yes, you know, we don't want to be like a Labrador with our tail wagging the whole time either. So, yeah, we have to calibrate.
Exactly. It's a difficult balance. I'd like to explore, let me have you talk first about sort of this idea that there are some people, not just men and women, some people who don't want to hear, choose not to, or would prefer not to hear a woman's voice. I mean, you focus on literature and Twitter, which I thought was so great, right? Because again, it provides such objective evidence, but I'm hoping you can say a little bit more about that.
Yeah. So this actually is a lot of the bias I've talked about is shared by women, but this is a particularly male phenomenon of some men not really wanting to expose themselves to women's voices in the first place. So it's not just that they're not according what we say with enough authority, it's they're not even listening to what we say in the first place. So studies show, for instance, that when it comes to reading books, women on average will read roughly 50-50 books written by men and books written by women. For men, the ratio is 80-20 on average. So they will read 4 books by a man for every 1 book by a woman, which I find very insulting. I very nearly describe myself as M.A. Sieghart on the cover, a la J.K. Rowling, you know, or P.D. James, just to try to get some men to read this book too, because the world won't change if it's only women who do. Right. And I really fought with the publisher to make sure that the cover design was just as appealing to men as to women. In fact, what I said was, the brief was, this is, by the way, is the UK version, the American one is different, but that's the British one. And I said, I want this to be the sort of book cover that a man won't feel embarrassed to be seen reading on the subway. And then I thought, how tragic, because I would never feel embarrassed to be seen reading a book by a woman. Mm-hmm. By a man.
Right.
And that sort of sums it up, doesn't it? that men somehow feel that it's embarrassing to be seen reading a book by a woman. But anyway, so I said, no pink, no curly writing. I want it really graphic, really bold. It needs to look like a sort of male deodorant ad, you know. But it's the same on Twitter. So women will follow roughly half and half men and women on Twitter. Men follow disproportionately other men, and they comment on and retweet disproportionately other men. And of course, comments and following and retweeting are the currency of Twitter. So if they're not even allowing us into their newsfeed, even if we're experts in their field, how can we be expected to be taken seriously by them? And this is something that men can correct very easily. I mean, just look at your bookshelves or your Kindle and see, out of the last 10 books you read, how many were by women. And if it's fewer than, you know, four or five, next couple of books you read could be by women. There are some fantastic books out there. Mm-hmm. I've just been judging the Women's Prize for Fiction this year, and there are some amazing novels by women which have come out in the last year. And there's a lot of good nonfiction too. But how often, for instance, do you see books by women on the smart thinking shelves of bookshops? I think that's very interesting. We tend to associate men with being smart thinkers. Plenty of brilliant books by women that ought to be on the smart thinking shelves.
Yeah. And I do actually have a follow-up question, but I would be remiss as a moderator if I didn't go back to Warm Authority, because right when I moved on, I got bombarded with questions. I think there is a lot of visceral reaction to the idea of warm authority, right? And the idea that this is our solution. And so I've got repeated questions saying, why should we adjust ourselves, right? Why should we have to adopt warm authority to appease men? Shouldn't they change their attitudes? Aren't we just perpetuating gender stereotypes if we, you know, push ourselves over into warm authority? So what would you say to that?
Okay, that is a really good question. And I'm just giving real world advice. And I think this is only a transitional solution. I think that once men become more aware of the tricks that stereotypes play in their brains, if they read this book or at least discuss this issue more and become more aware, eventually we won't have to do it. And once we get more women into authority, into authoritative positions, so it no longer feels so incongruous to see a woman exerting authority, again, the stereotype, that the bias in our brains will start to dissolve. So I see this simply as a transitional solution for the next generation or two, until we get much closer to equality. But I would be remiss also if I didn't advise it, because if I were to say to young women on the way up, just be yourself, just be completely authentic, behave like the men, they're going to lose out if I say that. And I would hate to be responsible for them not succeeding.
Right. So returning back now to this conversation about the female voice, and you focused on the written word, right? But my next question for you is sort of the oral sound, right, of a female's voice. And if you'll indulge me for a second, I had forgotten this until I was reading your book. But this happened about 10 years ago. I was a law school student, and I walked into my professor's office to ask. I had like a list of questions because I was preparing for exams. And he interrupted me mid first question. And he said, where are you from? But not in like a collegial, like nice way. And so I kind of described how it kind of moved around the Midwest. And he said, oh, that explains it. You have a really annoying voice, which you should think about as a litigator, because you're going to walk into a judge's room, courtroom, and he's not even going to listen to you because he's going to hate the sound of your voice. So you should think about that. I was 27 and I was stunned. And I just said, oh, okay. And he goes, yeah, right there with your O's, you sound, that's really annoying. You should never say okay. And so I almost said okay, but then he just instructed me not to. So I said, can I ask my questions? And for the longest time, I looked back on that situation and thought of it as sort of just like a sexist man, right? But what your book made me wonder is, to what extent was he really just voicing sort of a truthful bias against the sound of a woman's voice that others don't say because it's too shameful and embarrassing to actually admit it? But what would you say about that?
It's such a shocking story. And It's just awful because you must have felt so self-conscious every time you opened your mouth after that. I can't bear it. My heart bleeds for you. It is true that we associate deeper voices with authority. Mm-hmm. It's not clear, because it's terribly hard to disentangle, whether that's because male voices on the whole are deeper than women's and we associate male with authority. But it is true that even within the genders, a woman with a high voice will be seen as less authoritative than a woman with a low voice, and a man with a high voice will also be seen as less authoritative than a man with a low voice. So I'm talking simply about pitch here. I think with him, it was more manner of speech, I'm guessing. I don't know.
I'm not sure.
I'm not sure. I don't see what's wrong with saying okay, frankly. Or even oh. And your voice sounds lovely to me, by the way. But what's very interesting is that in more egalitarian countries, the average pitch of women's voices has dropped dramatically over the past few decades, whereas in inegalitarian countries such as Japan, it's remained very high. Because they are trained to sound submissive and feminine. And Japanese women will speak at a pitch in Japanese much higher than we ever will. So yeah. I thought that was interesting, that we are actually correcting our voices in order, well, I say correcting, lowering our voices in order to sound more like men, I think. And I suspect that's one reason why American women in particular quite often suffer from vocal fry. Because that happens when you lower your voice. But, you know, we had, a female commentator commentating for the first time on a really big football match. I think it was a World Cup, soccer, as you call it, match. And all these complaints from men saying, I couldn't listen. Her voice was so shrill and so screechy and so high. And what they were basically saying was, she was a woman. I couldn't listen to her voice. She was too female.
Yeah. I'm going to move on to a different topic only because I want to have enough time for you to speak about it. But I'd love to hear more about the intersection of the authority gap and race.
Yeah, huge, I'm afraid. So, you know, the gap is big enough for white women. It's even bigger, I'm sorry to say, for women of color. Women in general are twice as likely as men to say that they have to provide extra evidence of their competence. But Black women are twice as likely as white women, jolly nearly twice as likely to say that, and to say that people are surprised at their abilities, and to say that their manager isn't helping them with their career progression, and to say that they don't have access to senior leaders in their organization. So all these things that women complain about compared with men are magnified and multiplied by being a woman of color. And then when you overlay on that the racial stereotypes that go with the gender stereotypes, that also makes it harder. So, you know, if a Black woman is standing up for herself at a meeting, suddenly she's an angry Black woman, whereas she's actually justifiably annoyed by what's happened. And, you know, Asian women are expected to be submissive. So if they stand up for themselves, that's going against stereotype. And then on top of that, you get, you know, suppose a woman of color gets promoted to a great position in a firm and she's completely brilliant and utterly deserved it. But no, people assume it was just a diversity hire and it was affirmative action. And therefore, she's not going to be as good as her peers. So I'm sorry to say that race really compounds this, as do class and being a woman with disabilities. The evidence on sexuality is slightly more mixed. Because I think lesbians are allowed to behave in a slightly more masculine way. We don't find they're going against stereotypes so much if they're behaving in a more confident and assertive way. So I think actually the authority gap in some respects is narrower for lesbians than it is for straight women.
Mm-hmm. How about disabled women?
Oh, it's worst of all for women with disabilities, I'm afraid. I mean, people even assume that a woman with a physical disability also has a mental one. I mean, I interviewed a very senior female politician here in the UK who 10 years ago had to start using a wheelchair. I think she got rheumatoid arthritis. And she says more often than not, people will address the person pushing her wheelchair rather than her. It's as if she has somehow lost her mental ability just because she's sitting down.
Yeah. Right. And where does this authority gap come from, right? Because especially because we've talked about how it's so pervasive and it's not a generational problem, it continues to persist. And so where is it coming from?
Well, I mean, millennia of the patriarchy, I'm afraid. I mean, at every point in human history, men have been taught to believe they're superior to women, and women have been taught to believe they're inferior to men. And, you know, we're gradually getting over this just in the last few decades, but it's still very much imbued. It's in almost all our religions. I'm sure all of our grandparents thought that, and some of our parents probably did. So it's a big ask. I mean, all the evidence shows that women are just as competent as men, and there's no reason why they should be thought of as inferior. But nonetheless, we do have this huge history. But it does get passed down as well. I talked about parents treating their boys as cleverer than their girls. They also interrupt their daughters more than they do their sons, which, you know, makes boys believe that girls somehow are allowed to be interrupted more. Even at the age of five, children believe that boys are better than girls at math, even though they're not, actually. Mm-hmm. And between the age 6 and 7, if you start asking children to select teammates for a game for really, really smart kids, at the age of 5, girls will select girls and boys will select boys. But by 6 to 7, boys will still select boys, but girls start selecting boys too. So they're starting to imbue this notion that somehow the really smart kids are male rather than female. Mm-hmm. And partly from the world around them as well, isn't it? You know, look at children's books. They're improving now, but, you know, they used to be almost entirely young boy heroes doing all the fun, clever things with, you know, maybe female helpmeets if you were lucky. It's the same in movies that we watch. Male characters get twice as much speaking time as female characters. Women are much more likely to be portrayed as sex objects and helpmeets and murder victims. That, thankfully, has changed a lot. Only in the last 2 or 3 years, we started to see a lot more movies with really interesting agentic female characters, complex characters, not just sex objects and murder victims. So that will help, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we are just imbued with this notion that, you know, men are in charge, men are more expert than women. If you look at the experts who are interviewed in newspaper stories, for instance, news stories, about 3 or 4 times as many men as women on the whole. There are plenty of female experts who could be quoted, but the male journalists just automatically go to the male expert and quote him. So this is all subliminally telling us that men know more than women.
Right. You tell a story that happened to you in your book. You were, I think, invited to a news program of some sort, and it was you and a man. And there were 6 questions asked of the two of you, and the interviewer went to the man first on every single question, which is sort of astonishing. But did you say anything to him afterward? I know that you went to do a study and you published about that, but did you have a conversation with him? And, you know, just, you can answer that question, or if you don't want to, you can answer more broadly, right? How are we supposed to call out this type of behavior?
Well, actually, at the time, I think I was too flustered. So it was live television and I was really concentrating, you know, to get my point across. And so, and I sort of, it felt like I hadn't had a fair crack, but I wasn't quite sure why. So, and it wasn't till I went home and watched it back afterwards that I noticed that this host had gone to my male colleague 6 times out of 6. You know, you'd expect 3-3, 4-2, I would have forgiven, but 6-0 was just unacceptable. But it was too late by then to call him out in person. So I actually wrote a column about sexism in politics that week, and I included this as an example. So that was my revenge. His revenge was not to invite me back onto the program. But I did subsequently notice in another study that I commissioned that he was the most egregious offender when it came to not following women on Twitter. So I think the people he followed on Twitter was something like 85% male and only 15% female. And I thought, well, that's quite telling, isn't it?
Right.
Yeah. But how do we call it out? It is difficult. I mean, you know, the older I get, the easier it becomes, though. Mm-hmm. I still get sort of, I don't know, a sort of intake of breath when I do call it out quite often, and then feel like I'm somehow getting at them, even if I do it in the nicest possible way with lots of smiles. Mm-hmm. It is often easier because, as a woman, if you do call these things out, you will be written off as difficult and spiky and paranoid and all that, and prickly, oversensitive. It's often easier to recruit an ally to do it for you. So if there's a man who often does this in a meeting, then you can either take it up with the chair of the meeting afterwards and say, I don't know if you noticed, but John kept interrupting me and, you know, it's quite annoying and it means I can't get my point across. I wonder if you could have a quiet word with him or call him out next time. Mm-hmm. Or you can ask an ally at the meeting, you know, someone else who goes along to the meetings to say, oh, hang on a minute. I was really interested with what Melanie was saying there. You know, perhaps mm-hmm. you could let her finish. Mm-hmm. Or if you make a point and no one takes any notice and John makes it 10 minutes later, your ally or chair can say, oh, I'm so glad you agree with what Melanie said earlier.
Right. Yeah, absolutely. And that's definitely happened to me at meetings. I know I always feel so supported, right? So that's, okay. So yeah. I want to get to a question that we just received. And this is, okay. So in researching your book, did you come across studies or stories about how often men are aware or not aware of their gender biases, and to what extent men, institutions, and companies are willing to educate men on these biases so that they can be more aware and avoid acting on them?
There aren't that many studies on how aware or unaware men are of their biases, but there's a very interesting study of male scientists which shows that they are much more reluctant to accept evidence of gender bias than women are, and much more reluctant to accept evidence of gender bias than of racial bias. Even though they're scientists, and even though the evidence is peer-reviewed and scientific, they want to just sort of dispute it. Mm-hmm. So I thought that was interesting. I think there are, in my experience, there are three types of men. And the first type of men I absolutely love because they treat us with completely equal respect. They don't interrupt us. They do listen to us attentively. They respect us as much as they do other men. I love men like that. I really notice it. I really appreciate it. I'm sure you notice it too. And they should be role models for the other type of men. At the other end of the spectrum are not just men with unconscious bias, but frankly, conscious bias. They genuinely believe they're superior to women. They're damned if they're going to take in any evidence that proves the opposite. And they are the dinosaurs. I don't expect them to read my book. And I don't suppose they're going to change their mind, even if we try to change it for them. But I think there's a very critical mass of men in the middle who don't necessarily realize that what they're doing is creating this authority gap. They probably don't notice that they just take up too much of the conversational time in a meeting, usually at the expense of a woman. They don't notice that if they sit next to a woman at dinner, she asks all the questions and they don't ask any questions of her, that sort of thing. They don't notice that they interrupt women more than men, and would probably be horrified if this were all pointed out to them and would change their behavior. So they're the people I've written the book for, actually. For them to be more aware and think, oh, okay, yeah, I could actually change this. I could read more books by women. I could listen to women more attentively in meetings and not just automatically check my emails on my phone, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think that if that critical mass of men joins the first group, the fantastic group, that will marginalize the dinosaurs. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a bit like racism. 10 or 20 years ago, you could be in a room full of only white people and someone might feel they had a license to make a casually racist joke. They don't anymore. Thank goodness, because mm-hmm. other people are just going to call them out. I would like the same to be true of sexism, so that the dinosaurs realize they can't make sexist jokes anymore because the other men will call them out, not just the women.
Yeah. And you say in your book that you kind of see as moving in that direction, right? The positive direction. And can you articulate why that's so?
Well, I just think we're talking about these things more at last, and we're thinking about them more. And, you know, I think most organizations genuinely want to see more senior women, promote more women. And I think they need to be more aware of the culture, because I think a lot of women leave organizations because they come up against this sort of behavior and find it so annoying that they leave and maybe, you know, start their own business, that sort of thing. But I think that companies are just, organizations, employers are starting to have these conversations and becoming more aware of them. And women somehow feel that they have the license to speak out about it too. I think Me Too helped a lot. So it meant that we started talking about sexual harassment and worse. And I think that just emboldened us. It emboldened us to say it, but it also made the men realize they had to listen. Mm-hmm. And I think before they didn't, they often just dismissed it. A lot of men, not all of them.
Right. We have a couple of great questions here, so I'm going to try to get to them all. We have one question. You speak a little bit about benevolent sexism, right? And so the question is, how does that weaken a woman's ability to exercise authority?
Well, benevolent sexism is when you're sort of patted on the head, you know, oh, haven't you done well? I used to find this quite a lot, that I would meet a man at a party and he'd ask me what I did, if I was lucky, often didn't, you know, and I'd say, I'm a journalist. Freelance, he'd ask, you know, start at the bottom. And I'd say, no, actually, I'm on staff. Oh, he'd say, and then, and where do you work? The Times, I'd say, oh, and his voice would sort of go up. But every iteration, what do you do? That I'm an assistant editor, actually. Oh, and he probably thought that he was being benevolent. He was flattering me, you know, gosh, haven't you done well, dear? But actually, it was pretty insulting, because his assumption was that I was going to be junior and boring. And it turned out in the end that I wasn't. But it's insulting to assume that in the first place. And I think a lot of benevolent sexism does that. It makes people, it makes women feel small, because they're basically being patronized.
Right. We have a sort of similar question. So this particular person gave a speech, and after the speech, a woman told her, your speech was fantastic. You're going to be first lady one day, right? And she received other similar, you know, compliments. And the question is, do you have any insight on why people, even women, acknowledge a woman's skill and intelligence, yet still associate it with marrying a powerful person?
I mean, that's just shocking, isn't it? I wouldn't do that. I don't know. I guess, as I said earlier, it's because of the world we're brought up in, where, you know, the closest a woman has got to power in the US is to marry a president, not to be one so far. So it's just what we're used to. We have, you know, you haven't had a female president. There's a lot to be done, isn't there?
Yeah.
And actually, what was interesting, when Hillary was standing, I say Hillary rather than Clinton, because otherwise it's ambiguous, but when Hillary Clinton was standing against Trump, all the women who had voted for Obama, more or less, voted for her, but it was men who peeled off to Trump. And if all the men who had voted for Obama had also voted for her, she would have been president.
Mm-hmm.
So it was some men not being prepared to countenance the idea of a female president that allowed Donald Trump to win. And actually, the second most accurate predictor of voting for Trump in that election, after being a Republican, was having hostile sexist views.
Mm.
So I think there's a lot of resistance still in the US to a woman at the top.
Yeah. I thought your conversation with Hillary Clinton was super interesting, right? Because I'm going to have you tell the story, but she was commenting on, you know, how people were like, oh, I just don't like her, right? Like woman, I like women, but not that woman. And then, you know, her views on what happened when there were a lot more women running a few years later.
Yeah. So, you know, I was talking about how women acting like men, or in other words, just showing leadership, it's all you have to do is show leadership, makes you dislikable. And in fact, being so-called power seeking evokes feelings of disgust in people if you're a woman, not if you're a man. And of course, if you're running for office, by definition, you're seeking power. And so, yes, when Hillary was running in 2016, a lot of people would say, oh, of course, I'd be happy to vote for a female president, for a woman, just not that woman, because there's something about her, people used to say, there's something about her that I just don't like. And then 4 years later, enough women to run a basketball team were running, at least in the Democratic primaries. And the same thing happened. It was, yes, of course, I'd be happy to vote for a woman, but just not those women. And as Hillary said, you know, what were the chances of every single one of those women being dislikable? Didn't it actually tell us more about our attitude towards women seeking power rather than the women themselves?
Right. So I just got a 5-minute warning. So I want to turn to, you know, what can we do to narrow the authority gap? And you have this great chapter on that. And so I want you to spend a bit of time talking about that.
Can I quickly tell you what men can gain from narrowing the authority
gap? Yes, that's a very important question.
Yes, because I really don't want men to feel that they're somehow being altruistic and letting women in and that they're going to suffer. Because actually, all the evidence shows, and this is really encouraging for us women, that in more gender equal countries and more gender equal US states, they've studied that, and in more gender equal relationships, straight relationships, that is, where the man and the woman share the chores and the childcare roughly equally. Not only are the women happier and healthier, which you might expect, and the children are happier and healthier, and they do better at school, have fewer behavioral difficulties, get on much better with their dad, but the men are happier and healthier too. So they're twice as likely to say they're satisfied with their lives, half as likely to be depressed, much less likely to get divorced. They tend to drink less, smoke less, take fewer drugs, get more sleep at night. And here's the absolute clincher, guys. They get more frequent and better sex. So what's not to like about this? This is absolutely in your interest too. What can we do? I counted the other day, there are 140 suggestions in my last chapter. And the reason there are so many is because every individual instance of the authority gap may seem small at the time. You know, you get interrupted and oh, it's annoying. It's not career ending, but they accumulate, they roll up like compound interest over the course of a lifetime to create this big gap between women and men. And as a result, every solution probably has to be quite small, like noticing if you're interrupting women more than men and just stopping doing it. But I do have quite a lot of advice for employers, and there's lots of really interesting stats. For instance, that if you have only one woman on a selection panel, that actually reduces the chances of the female candidate being hired or promoted, because the men will think, we don't have to think about diversity, we'll leave it to her. And the woman thinks, if I promote the woman, the men will think I'm being nepotistic. So there's all sorts of really interesting evidence in that last chapter about things that employers can do, having two women on a selection panel, having more than one woman on a shortlist, using blind applications for jobs, gender blind, so you don't know whether it's a man or a woman applying. 70% of men will evaluate a man more highly than a woman for achieving the same goals. So that's what we're up against, this sort of bias. That's also affinity bias, I think.
Yeah.
But yeah,
you describe in your book as well, like a reaction from reading a CV and never even meeting the person, right? But the reaction was pretty startling. It was, yeah, this woman, you know, seems to boast about herself a lot and doesn't seem, yeah, like a team player. And it's like a CV, you know, the person didn't even get an interview. It was pretty.
Exactly. Obvious. Because we don't like self-promoting women. So she was simply putting her achievements, and she had a very high GPA. She was obviously very intelligent, lots of experience. And they said she sounded arrogant. They would never have thought that about a man and didn't want to hire her as a result. So she wasn't even called for interview.
Right.
Women aren't allowed to self-promote. So for instance, if you ask in an interview, tell me the achievement you're proudest of, which you might think is a very benign question to ask, that will really trip women up, because they know they're not allowed to promote themselves in the way that men are allowed to do. And so they're much more likely to say something like, oh, I'm so proud of my lovely children. Whereas a man will say, well, I achieved this, this, and this in my last job. And people will think, well, he's obviously better than she is. No, he's just been socialized a different way, and we've been socialized a different way to react to them.
Right.
So, well, I mean, the main message in the book, I think, is we don't need to fix women. We need to fix how we perceive and react to and interact with women. And that's men as well as women need to do that. So this is not a book just for women, it's for men too.
Right. That's sort of the takeaway I read. I was like, I need to give this to my husband, my dad. This is written for one reader, me, although it was also written for me.
One reader said that she had put it on the audiobook on in the car on a long journey with her husband. And she said, it's transformed him. He listens to me now, he asks me questions. And so I just think, if I can change the world one husband at a time, I'll be very happy.
Right. Well, it's a huge accomplishment. It's a wonderful book. Everybody, if you haven't read it, should please go get it. This discussion has been fantastic. I hope the whole audience enjoyed it as much as I did. And thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. It's been a real pleasure.